The image that is being shown to you right now is 18,000 BC, that means about 20,000 years ago. There are images of homes or buildings built in triangular forms, which are over 8,000 years, that's 6,000 BC, in places like Romania. There are skeletal images of to leave your body with your legs crossed in a proper Siddhasana posture. Now in Lebanon, this is a classic representation of Guru Puja stone. Over 15,000 years ago, in the upper regions of Himalaya, a yogi appeared. Nobody knew where he came from, who he was. His antecedents were unknown, because people did not know his name. They referred to him as Master. He just came and sat down. This is very important to understand that it is in the last 12 to 15,000 years that the longing to know got organized and found an organized expression through various systems of yoga. It's fantastic to see that this goes back right up to the time of the Adi Yogi. If we want to look for physical proof, still there's a little bit of physical proof left around the world suggesting these things. I'm not some kind of an archaeologist or an expert in these matters but you will see some of the things that we will look at today will intrigue anyone and set us thinking. We cannot call this 100% proof, but it suggests a few things. What is this all about? Why this has to be connected to Saptarishis? Because it's a particular way of looking at life. When I say particular way of looking at life, it is not about someone's opinion, but it is about an internal reflection of the cosmos, an internal understanding of the nature of creation, and a very internalized understanding of a human being and the making of a human being and every other creature on this planet. When I say internal, I am talking about in contrast with modern science, which observes everything from outside and gone quite deep into its observation today as to how the physical creation has happened. It is in no way in contradiction with the inner way of looking, it is just that it starts at a different end. It's like if you start looking at a tree from the top, your understanding of the tree will be one way. If you start looking at a tree from its roots, your understanding of the tree will be completely different. Only when a meeting point happens somewhere, they look similar. Today we are coming to a place in the history of modern science and in the development of modern science where mysticism and modern science are beginning to look similar. So, this exploration today will be important in that sense and as I said, this is not an archaeology lesson for you, but it's just to show you that there have been many suggestions to show that the origin of this is Adiyogi and from him how it could have reached various places. Within myself, I know it did, but you don't have to go by my experience of life because somebody else's experience can never be yours. But here is a little bit of physical proof going around. This whole process of Adiyogi and transmission of this way of knowing started in the region that today we refer to as Manasarovar and Kailash. And from there it spread to places, in different spaces they went. There are many references to the seven sages, particularly in Central Asia, Turkey, Romania, as far as Northern Africa, Arabia, there are continuous references to seven sages in the tradition, even today it is, and you will see in Arabia, in places like Lebanon, Egypt, Morocco, Tunisia, Sudan, in all these places, even today popular restaurants are named as seven sages. So that is how much prevalent it is even today. When you ask these people who the seven sages are, nobody knows who the seven sages are in the common knowledge of the people. But from generation to generation for thousands of years, the idea of seven sages coming from the east, seven wise men coming from the east is still very much prevalent in most of the cultures out there. For example, you will see the images of snake worship going back right up to 18,000 BC in places like Siberia and Central Asia. These are very rudimentary images, you must understand, because they are so rudimentary, not because the people who made these things were rudimentary in their mind, but because the tools available to do this was rudimentary. Nobody can ever dig up the whole planet to find out if there are more sophisticated expressions of this. It is just that when you spread a message, just everybody may start doing things. The image that is being shown to you right now is 18,000 BC, that means about 20,000 years ago. The approximate date that we established for Adiyogi's presence in this region is somewhere between 40,000 to 60,000 years ago. You might have heard that many times I've been saying it is 15,000 years ago, because for 15,000 years we have solid physical proof, iconographic proof, which is over 12,000 years old. Because of that, we have been saying 15,000, but when I have spoken long time ago, 10, 12 years ago, I've always spoken in terms of 40,000 to 60,000 years ago, because in the yogic culture, that is how it is seen. But today, without a proof, if you say something, it'll become meaningless in the world. Because of that, we have brought down the date to 12,000 to 15,000 years. Here is 18,000 BC, which is 20,000 years ago. They made calendars, which is purely the yogic form of calendar. You will see in India any number of pictures like this. Here is this third image, or the first image which is made into a diagram in the third phase, is three sets of spirals. The central set of spirals and the lower set together represents the solar cycle calendar, which is 364 days, which is the year that we follow even today. And the upper set refers to 354 days, which is the lunar cycle of the calendar, which is what the Hindu calendar follows even today. And a combination of these two, which is today being referred to as lunisolar calendar, this is 20,000 years old, and somebody cannot arrive at this without an inner perspective. Just by observation of the outside, one cannot arrive at a calendar like this, which is, this is a very sophisticated manifestation of the calendar. If this is written in Braille, even if a blind person puts his hands around, he will know which day of the year it is, which day of the month it is, and which face of the moon it is. All these things can be found out just by touching the rock or looking at it. And along with that comes snake worship, which is the three snakes going up. This is a representation of Ida, Pingala and Sushumna, the three channels within the body. So this is a very yogic expression. India is full of these kind of images. This was found in Siberia, which is dated as 18,000 BC right now by the archaeologists. There are images of homes or buildings built in triangular forms, which are over 8,000 years, that's 6,000 BC, in places like Romania. Eastern Europe and Central Asia is full of these kind of possibilities. If you look at the geometric perfection of how it is done, this is the basic form of yantra. Triangular block in Isha Yoga Center is built exactly like this. Unfortunately, we are not 8,000 BC, we are now. We built this only about 22 years ago. And they built a perfect yantra-shaped building for whatever purposes that they were doing this. Obviously, these are aligned properly to the eastern direction, and these directions are adjusted to either equinox or solstice usually. Our own buildings like Dhyanalinga and triangular block are adjusted to the equinox, because equinox is significant for me in my perception of life. That is, 23rd of September is a equinox, and because my understanding of everything comes from the equinox, I adjusted it to the equinoxes, some of them adjusted to the solstice. For the Saptarishis, solstice must have been definitely be a most important aspect of their life, because it is on that day for them, Adiyogi opened up the doors for them. So if you go on like this, there are any number of possibilities. As we go further to Turkey, to further down to Mesopotamian region, Greece, Crete, further down to places like Lebanon and North Africa, you will see geographically every place has something to say where the influence is yogic in its nature, and a whole lot of them going back, way back, to like 12,000, 13,000 years. For example, we can see here in Turkey, which is dated as 10,000 BC. This is a very typically Indian image in the terms of a linga or a head with a snake climbing on it, because this is the yogic symbolism of a human being's inner potential being aroused. Or it is the symbolism of Kundalini. Similar images are found as far as South America, in Peru, in Ecuador, in that region. One must understand, most of these things have been either destroyed by age, and the natural processes that happen on the earth in terms of earthquakes and other events that happened, at the same time they've also been systematically destroyed by certain forces in the last, 2000 years or so. Systematic destruction of anything which was considered pagan happened in many areas and either buried or broken or destroyed or used as material to build other buildings that they wish to build. In spite of that, there is substantial evidence spreading across the planet showing that the influence of the seven sages, the yogic culture and the science of yoga manifesting itself in so many ways. We must understand the proof that we are talking about according to today's archaeological substance is only the physical proof. Today you are doing yoga in United States. Suppose 1,000 years later somebody wants to find out how. How will they find yoga in you? So there will be no proof in your home, there will be no proof anywhere that you are practicing yoga in your life. So it is only when we manifest something which is physical, which is made in such a way that it will last forever, only then we can talk about it. But even for this, we can show, we can see that thousands of years ago people practicing yoga, they lived and died in yogic postures. There are skeletal images of people sitting in that could be you when you were doing your Shambhavi Mahamudra, you happened to die. Or you attain enlightenment and you are conscious enough to leave your body with your legs crossed in a proper Siddhasana posture. See, here somebody died doing Shambhavi, or they died in a Siddhasana posture some 8,000 years ago in Romania. And if this one person did this, I am sure this is not the only person who did this. There must have been a whole culture of this dimension. And there are any number of images showing people sitting in yogic postures. This is usually the representation of Pashupati as one dimension of Adiyogi. That is, he is the Pashupati. They called him Pashupati because all the life forms are claimed to a certain genealogy. And because he exhibited or he demonstrated how everything comes from the same source and that source is nothingness and he is a representation of that, because of that he was called as Pashupati. And also because when he when he sat in certain states, it is something that people have witnessed, that all kinds of creatures gathered around him. Because all of them gathered around him, people saw him as the lord of all creatures and he is the Pashupati. This is a representation of that. A repetition of these images across the planet in various forms and in various different manifestations of art has found expression in cave arts going as far back as 8,000–10,000 years. And when I say cave paintings and arts, you must understand, today your child is drawing something in your house and sticks it on the wall, and if somebody finds it 10,000–15,000 years later, the chances of finding it, how remote it is, that is how remote it is for us to find those things. They might have done a million artworks, we may find one or we may not. So in spite of that, so much has been found. We can go on like this in various places, all these manifestations, but the more recent ones would be a certain tribe of people who identified themselves as Minoans. It's called the Minoan culture, or they were also called as Manus in Germany. And in German language, the word Manus means the first man. which has been the essential representation in India. Manu is referred to as the first man the man. Manu is not a person, Manu is the man, like people refer to Adam in the West. Manu is a man or the origin of the man. When we say a man, that does not exclude a woman, we are referring to a human being as a man. It is somewhere down the line that the usage became like this when societies became more and more patriarchal and man-oriented. The word that was used to describe a human being started describing only a man, and they had to find another word to describe the female of the species. In Minos in Crete, which is a Greek island today, and Manu in India, in many ways go parallel in their descriptions and the way things are described. The manifestation, the now that we are looking at these Saptarishis as being the transmitters of Adiyogi's teaching, naturally wherever they went, the representation of the snake, the bull, and the form of the linga manifested itself. You will see in places like Ireland, in very strong representation of the linga worship. The people in Brittany, when I say Brittany, in France, a region which is called Brittany, and when I happened to be in Brittany, they were very excited and they took me to a temple which is supposed to be 6,000 years old, where they were still worshipping the four elements, and they said, "We came from northern Gangetic plain, and it is our brothers who went to the island, which today is known as Britain." He said, "This is real Brittany." So this goes on endlessly, there's a whole lot of pictures we could show you, and there's a whole lot of material which may be a little too much for you to digest in this little time that we have. But we will just run through these pictures for you to just see, for yourself to make out. I will not really say much about it, but just look through this, just see how intriguing and wonderful it is that going way back, the oldest picture that we have is dated as 20,000 years ago. Here is Ireland, you see this snake symbolism, which is typically yogic. And here is the worship of linga. And the three… this spiral, which is the cosmic representation, or it is the manifestation of what we call as the saligram. The inside of the saligram is made like this. This is the image of the ammonite is used as saligram, because that is the representation, the yogic representation of the cosmic galaxies. This is 2000 BC. These spirals, this has been one of our thing to build an underground spiral like this in the Indian Yoga Center. We've still not managed to do this. As a process of meditation to go through the spiral, if you go through a dark spiral like this, if at the end of it, you will naturally become meditative. We've been wanting to build a proper spiral, a geometrically correct spiral, which only that bottom corner one is the right one, but we are yet to do it. Here is Zeus worshipped as a serpent. The serpent worship is very deep-rooted in every culture on the planet. Of course, you must have seen the Naga temple in the yoga center. This is the image that we have today in the yoga center, but somewhere around 700 BC, a Jewish king ordered that all snake temples must be destroyed because for whatever his own reasons. So systematically, these things were broken in that region, Otherwise, the whole of Arabia, Eastern Europe, Northern Africa, South America were full of snake worship and temples were snake worship. Wherever anybody connected with Adiyogi goes, naturally the manifestation of snake and snake worship would be there. Even today, the modern medical sciences using spiral snakes. Mesopotamia, you see many images of this. You must see this in Turkey and Iraq region. There are plenty of broken parts of snake worship. The symbol of commerce even today is a spiral snake with seven meeting places. The symbol of health is three and a half spirals of the snake, which is something that we are using in so many ways. Dhyana Linga is seven-pointed spiral, and Devi Bhairavi is three and a half spiral. This is how these images are made. This is a physical representation. This could be manifested in so many different ways. This is common knowledge, biblical knowledge, that Moses used a copper snake or a brass snake to cure people of various things. And this snake worship continued. At some point, even Jesus spoke something about snake worship. There is a statement by Jesus about snake worship or a brass this thing, because in the language of that region, the word snake and the word brass are very similar sounding. So somewhere, I don't know the exact place, but those in America should know this better. The rising of the man is the rising of the snake. This is clearly a yogic statement, that the rising of the kundalini is the ultimate rising of the human being, because without raising your energy to a higher dimension, the evolution of a human being, or thinking that a human being is genuinely changing, is an illusory process. Because whatever changes you make in your attitude and your intentions are purely psychological, and they can be washed away in a moment. If you lose your mind, you would have lost it. But the raising of the human being is only when the energy, the latent energy which we refer to as kundalini, which is clearly represented as a coiled up snake in the yogic system, it is only in the raising of that there is a permanent transformation in a human being. This is a statement made by Jesus in the Bible, saying that the rising of the snake is the rising of the man, or the rising of the man is the rising of the snake. So these are all different things which says the influence of the yogic system goes right back to 18-20,000 years in terms of archaeological proof, and there is really no part of the planet. I think the only place they did not go is North Pole and South Pole. Maybe in the Eskimo culture, it does not exist. Literally everywhere else, some influence of this is seen, and it has spread across. And all this done without any kind of compulsiveness, without any kind of force, only by showing the significance of what it is. And there are beautiful representations of more sophisticated manifestation of yogic culture, particularly in Middle East or West Asia, as we call it here. Particularly this particular stone that you're seeing is the Guru Puja stone. When I went to Baalbek, which is part of the Phoenician temple, which was built in now in Lebanon. When I happened to visit this place about 10 years ago, the moment I saw this stone, which is the Guru Puja stone, with 16 offerings, with room for 16 offerings, Even today when we do Guru Puja, it is called as Shodashopachara. That means 16 ways of inviting a guru, 16 ways of making it happen. This is a classic representation of Guru Puja stone. You will find an exactly similar stone in Uttarkashi. You will find these stones in Banaras. You will find these stones in southern India, in various temples. The triangle, the manifestation of the stone in the way it is done is geometrically 100% correct. This cannot be done by anybody other than somebody who is steeped in yogic sciences. And this must be about 4,500 to 5,000 years old in intact, even today in Lebanon. Lebanese children in their schools study, and they know from history that Indian sculptors, Indian labor, Indian elephants came to work on the Phoenician temples. If all these people went, if the labor went, the sculptors went and the elephants went, how would the yogis not be there? They would be the forerunners of this whole process. And you will see in Baalbek temple there's another image of lotuses in the ceiling. Obviously this is a clear Indian art sneaking into Phoenician temple, because the sculptors from India, the first thing that they learn is to make a lotus. It's the simplest manifestation of sculpting, and they put it in the ceiling of these Phoenician temples almost 4,500 to 5,000 years ago. The people in that region would have definitely not seen a lotus, because no such thing exists there. But you will see lotuses hanging from the ceiling. This is a lotus inside Anahata symbol in the ceiling of the Phoenician temple, the Sun Temple in Lebanon, which is called as Baalbek. This is a fantastic temple. It's a must-see for anybody. If you ever happen to be in that region, it is something that one must see. It is a phenomenal manifestation of human will as to how and the inspiration that is taken from a divine contact. Once somebody is touched by something of the beyond, your own earning of the bread or making your own name and fame doesn't arise. You want to create something that manifests itself and functions beyond yourself. So these ancient temples are a manifestation of that. You see the symbol, the yogic symbols of Anahata and the blossoming of the flower. It is across the planet in many, many representations in the form of sculpture. Once again, we must remember only that which was carved on stone and that which endured the ravages of time you see, but so much of it which is in practice will never be seen, unless like that skeletal representation where someone died in a yogic posture. If that happens only, maybe there will be proof of yoga in North America after 10,000 years. So these are all various symbolisms. I will not go into this. This is Jordan. You can see a manifestation of the linga forms and the crescent moon and snakes. This is very important. This is a three-headed bull. Before, the first one is in Sumeria, but we have these things in Indus Valley. Whoever fixes these dates, on what basis, I do not know. We will go by that. And this is about 5,000 years, where three-headed bull is a representation of the same process of the Ida, Pingala and the Sushumna. Represented as a bull, later on evolved, or parallelly it also evolved into three-headed snakes or three snakes, these three-headed bulls. And there are wonderful stories going back in many ways. For those of you who are familiar, or if you happen to attend the Leela program about the way Krishna represented yoga. There's a beautiful story about Krishna taming the bull. There is a whole lot of stories going back into history where this was… today it is being labeled as bull jumping, where people conquering the bull was not only a macho manifestation in a society, but it was also considered as a spiritual pursuit, that if you conquer the bull within you, that means you conquer your animal nature, that is when you are delivered. So these two things are very much there in Krishna's life of he taming a bull and then dancing upon the hood of a snake. So these two things are a symbolic representation of how he tamed the animal nature within himself and arrived at a place where he's on top of a snake's hood, representing that he's reached, the snake has risen within him, so the man has risen. That is what these two stories are trying to say. Here is a beautiful manifestation of a linga and a yogic symbol of seven dimensions of life peeking out and the human figure in between. These are different art forms trying to say the same thing. So this is from the Indus Valley, okay, this is in the Indian region. Here is a 2000-year-old Egyptian snake with a crescent on top of it. And here what you see is the snake, which is the Linga Bhairavi temple. This is the symbol of infinity, they representing infinite nature or cosmic arousal of energy, which is also possible within an individual human being. So this is called as the Arborus in today's language. This happened a few years ago. I was in conversation with a physicist, and we had 6-7 hours of non-stop unbroken conversation, and I was trying to demonstrate to him, and if you become meditative or if you get settled in a certain way within yourself, if you hold one's hand let's say 9 to 12 inches above my head right now, you can clearly feel the energy moving in this form. And I said, this is a dimension which represents you across the physical limitations. If you hold your hand on top of anybody's head, please don't go about experimenting like this and proving something about someone else. But you will see the energy will always move this way. The moment it has hit this form, that means he's crossed the physical limitations within himself. When I said this, and crossing physical limitations also means moving from finite to infinite, it is on that day that I you know, I logically connected. He said, this physicist told me that this is the symbol we use for the expression of the infinite. I said, well, this is from the yogic culture, only someone who has known this within himself could have used that. So the number system, the zero and the infinite, both came from the yogic culture. Today when you say shunya, which is the zero, nobody could have thought of a zero except one who has experienced that sense of emptiness and the vastness of emptiness. When we say emptiness, the word emptiness or nothingness naturally brings psychologically a negative connotation. But emptiness means limitlessness, nothingness means limitlessness, nothingness also means infinite nature. That can only be arrived at experientially, not logically, not by thought, but only by experience. So it is not an accident that both the zero and the infinite comes from the yogic basis, and that has become the basis of all modern sciences today. Everything that you do is between zero and infinite, but crossing these two boundaries is what is considered ultimate yoga, because true union happens only when you transcend the numbers. Numbers means finite nature. Only when you cross this, there is a true union, then only you can say something is in a state of yoga. This is a coiled snake. This is 1,000 years ago. When you enter Spanda Hall in the yoga center, we have a very similar representation. Everybody has to walk over this, because Spanda literally means a state of primordial energies. Today the same cultures are very fearful and giving negative images of snakes, but the same cultures at a certain time worshipped snakes, and because of a certain campaign, snake has become evil. But even that campaign is not a complete success, because it contradicts itself. For example, if you take the story of Adam and Eve, there was a dumb couple who did not know what to do, and a snake arrived and it initiated life. Someone who initiates life upon this planet, it's up to you whether you call him the agent of the divine or call him the agent of the devil. If you are for life, you would definitely call him as the agent of the divine. If you are anti-life, then you would call him as the agent of the devil. Here are our beautiful snakes, cascading snakes at the entrance of Dhyanalinga temple. This is the Linga Bhairavi. Someday, maybe when I stop traveling around, when I sit down in place, the science behind this, we can experientially manifest for those who are interested as to how all sounds are leading towards this, are rooted in this dimension. That is what the previous image was about. These are South American manifestations of someone trying to build a rudimentary Dhyanalinga. This is very interesting. Geographically, today in the country that we call as Peru, it's called Chavin. This is a classic, it will be too arrogant for me to say it's a classic reproduction of Dhyanalinga site. Dhyanalinga is a classic reproduction of this one. We were not aware of this at that time, but now it's really fantastic to see exactly in a similar kind of magnetic and other kind of forces which work on the planet. Someone tried to establish a very similar setup of an energy center. This is the plan from the top, but you will see so many things which are very similar. You will see it's very, very similar in construction to the Dhyanalinga complex in terms of the plan, the way we did the approaches as to how it should be to make it experientially possible for people who enter the temple. When we built Dhyanalinga, we were not aware of these things, but today people have researched into these things and found out. This is a 7 snakes coming out of a human being's head. These are all yogic representations of the rising of the Kundalini. This is in South America a few 1,000 years ago. This is an art form of a depiction of somebody using a mudra like this and initiating someone. These are classic images of the Guru Shishya Paramparya in its own form in those cultures. This is I don't know if you can call it a pyramid, it's not a pyramid really. It's somewhere in Central America. So, on the spring equinox, it leaves an image like a coil, I mean, like a snake going up with 7 forms of bends going up. Only on that one day it happens. The equinox is a tremendous possibility. In some way, the whole effort has been to create forms which will help a human being to attain to his fullest form. So various types of mechanisms were created. Some are very sophisticated, some are rudimentary in nature, but the effort has been there all over the world. So here we are today seeing the impact of yogic systems across the planet. Whatever these images and stuff we're talking about is only what is left of in form of physical things, but the impact that would have happened, for example, right now, for most of you who are in North America or in United States, for a few thousand people who are doing Isha Yoga, let's say, or a few million people across the world who are doing Isha Yoga, let's say after 10,000 years, where is the proof that you did yoga? There may be still a few stones left in Dhyanalinga. In case we build something in Tennessee, there may be a few stones left there. So somebody will say after 10,000 years, in two different places, somebody was seemed to be doing some yoga. But a few millions people are doing, and many other millions of people are doing different forms of yoga. All that will not be left. So similarly, when you see one image like this, there must have been a whole population or a generation of people or many generations of people doing this, otherwise the continuity of it for the last 20,000 years manifesting like this would not happen unless it was an active culture across the world and which has been systematically wiped out in the last couple of thousand years for whatever reasons. There is lore in South America where they are talking about people from another, wherever, landed there some 6,000-7,000 years ago, and suddenly tribes who were living without any engineering capabilities, their highest level of engineering was a leather tent, which is called a tepee. From there, suddenly they started building constructions, stone constructions which have even lasted till today, which are masterpieces of engineering. So they say the gods came from elsewhere and taught them this. In the lore, this is how it is. I want you to just imagine, 6,000 years ago, if somebody came floating on an ocean, on whatever they floated upon, and landed in your land. Suppose you were in Indiana and somebody came floating 6,000 years ago, when you had not imagined anything beyond the land on which you exist, they definitely would look like gods who came from elsewhere. And they brought in mathematics, they brought in engineering, geometry, and other dimensions, and suddenly those who were living in tents suddenly started building constructions which are… which do not… you cannot… culture cannot evolve from a rudimentary tent which is just put up with a piece of leather and stick to a sophisticated construction in just a short span of time. It will take a whole lot of time for people to evolve that, unless an input came from elsewhere. The suggestions that the input came from elsewhere, which you can call it gods or you can say they are saptarishis or wherever they came from, yes, definitely they came from elsewhere. Everything suggests they could only come from the east and not from anywhere else. So you could assume if you wish, if it assists your Indian ego, you can say these people came from India. Not Indiana, I mean India. So if it is… because this would be very presumptuous to say, yes, this is saptarishis. But a lot of things indicate it could be them. It would be very presumptuous for anybody to say, yes, this is so, because there is no such thing. But in my experience, within myself, I know these seven sages reached out to the whole world, and because that was Adiyogi's intention and that's how they went, and there are more, what to say, believable stories. At the time of Mahabharata, Arjuna decides to… See, we must understand this one thing, that if you go through the Indian lore, if you go as far back as 5,000-6,000 years ago, very clearly they're talking about the planet being round. In fact, even today, in the local languages in India, when we say geography, we say bhugol. Bhugol means study of a globe. The very word is suggesting that the earth is round. So, this is not like whatever a few hundred years ago Galileo invented that… discovered that earth is round. For thousands of years we've been talking about it. You should see the descriptions in Mahabharata where when Vayu takes Kunti Devi, he takes her across the world and for the first time she sees and realizes that the planet is round and she talks about it and she couldn't believe that actually you can go round and come back. So they're talking about Vayu as the god of winds who took her around. She realized that the planet is round. There are any number of things to suggest that people were traveling or people did travel to those parts of the world. And also if you go back further, 18,000 or 20,000 BC, during the Ice Age, largely these continents were connected that people could have even walked across, not necessarily gone by… traveled by the sea, but they could have walked across because land masses was connected one way or the other. So it is possible. If you look at the knowledge that suddenly they exhibited, we can say definitely it is so, but we don't have exact proof to say it is so.